Good morning, gang. It's Saturday, the 25th of July, 2015. A warm welcome along to today's United Kingdom Talk on this rather sunny day. What a difference it is to yesterday. Rain virtually all day long, boys and girls. However, the sun has appeared and already I have achieved vast things this morning. Yes, remember those new plants that I bought from, Gardens For You? Now, I must admit, I thought I was saving a bit of money on here. But actually, looking at the individual prices of the plants, which came through in boxes from Germany. Germany! They came in boxes from Germany. They're probably dearer than the ones I bought outside Waitrose. But never mind, they're here anyway. And they arrived, was it yesterday? I think they arrived yesterday about 10:30 in the morning, all in these black cardboard boxes. And I took them out of the boxes and they did look rather sorry after being enclosed in a brown cardboard box, you know, for God knows how long. I suppose about 24 hours, something like that. How long does something take to get here from Germany? I don't know. Is that like an overnight thing? Does it come within 24 hours? I don't know. So they were looking rather sorry, but I took them straight out of the boxes, put them outside in the rain yesterday. They had a whole 24 hours full of rain and they've had a bit of sun this morning and they immediately have burst into life again. A little bit like me. Oh yes, in bed, I do look dead. I look dead in bed, apparently, apart from the noises that I make. Now, when I've had to share a room with someone, more recently, Ronnie, when I went up to visit my sister, we had a twin room in a little hotel called the Claveron. Oh, what was it? I can't remember what it was called, but it was nice. A bed and breakfast. Bit hot in the room, to be honest, but it was okay. Apparently, I make noises at night. A few people have told me this. You know, like that, apparently. I mean, I've never heard myself, to be honest, and I'm almost tempted, because there are apps you can buy for the phone, you know. Oh, yes, that you can record yourself while you are sleeping. And I'm thinking, that might be a good idea. I might say something that I would otherwise miss had I not recorded myself. That's why I do these shows. They're all recorded. All the shows are recorded. And I record them and watch them back just in case I've missed something that I might have said. It's a very sensible way about going things, I think. Now, you can join in today by Skype. United Kingdom Talk. Now, if you're watching the live stream on YouTube, you can't quite see that, I don't think. Shall I move? Just a minute. Is that... That's it. There we are. Okay, so now and again, I'll move to the side and then you can see it better. The Skype is United Kingdom Talk. There's also a local London phone-in number, 0208-144-3477. 0208-144-3477. Operators are standing by to take your call. We must already say this morning to a few people who have appeared on Skype, Wendy. Good morning, Wendy. Who says I look very smart today? Yes, thank you. My fashion advisor this morning was Terry H, who's probably watching at this moment while laying a little pillow on his bed. Are you, Terry, or are you up yet? I've achieved much this morning. You know, while you've been sitting there, I've been out in the garden, dear, planting some of my new plants. Yes, they're already in. Not all of them, though. Some of them. Most of them. In fact, I'm looking at them and I'm thinking I might have bought too many. But there's always a gap for a new plant, isn't there? Come on, gardeners. You know what it's like. You're out in that garden centre and... Oh, that's lovely. Oh, I don't know where I'd put that. But you buy it anyway, don't you? And then you find a little gap for it. Yes! And that's what I've been doing. Although I've nearly run out of bone meal. Bone meal, crushed bones and fish blood, apparently. I mean, I could give myself, not to medical science, but to a gardening centre when I'm dead. I could be crushed up and I could become an apple tree. Just spread me around at the bottom of those roots and I'll come back as apples and you can eat me all up. Yum, yum, yum. Almost as nice as that lovely custard cream I had last night, Wendy. You know the very, very big large ones that was making your mouth water last night? Well, like, you could be eating me as an apple. Or if you don't like natural things, I could be turned into an apple crumble or an apple pie. Possibly with a bit of cinnamon sprinkled on the top. Or I'm not bothered if I were to become a McDonald's apple pie. Now, I quite like McDonald's apple pies. It's probably about the only thing in there I like. That and the tea isn't too bad. McDonald's apple pies, I think, are the best. What do you reckon? Deep fried apple pie. Yes, please, send some round now, please. So I could be turned into one of those when I'm dying, when I'm crushed up and I'm fed as bone meal and blood to the plants below. But will they want it? That's the question. You'll probably get something very nasty off one of those apples that you're eating. Huh? Good morning to Simon Steele. Good morning, Simon. If you're making noises during the night, don't have curry for dinner. I do not have curry. I haven't had a curry for ages. Ages and ages. Although, vegetable curry? Yes, please. Cook me some, Simon. Send it over. Courier. I'll be very pleased to accept that. Thank you. Simon's on the Isle of Wight. A wonderful place to be, boys and girls, especially right now when people are queuing for hours on end trying to get over to France. I mean, why would anyone ever want to go to France through Eurotunnel at this particular moment in time? Have you seen the trouble going on there? Have you seen the pictures of the M20 motorway, which is the one that goes right down to Kent, you know, right down to the Channel Tunnel there? Madness. Absolute madness. Some of those lorries have been waiting days. I mean, what have those lorries got on them anyway? Apart from migrants. Is there food in there going off? Just imagine being one of those lorry drivers and you're stuck and there's nothing you can do. Just stuck there, bored to tears, in this traffic that cannot move. Because of the migrants. Or, which happens quite often, French port workers, or something to do with that, on strike yet again. They know how to strike there, don't they? Setting up fires on the road and all that business. Awful. In many of the papers this morning, they're talking about the problems going through Eurotunnel at the moment. On the BBC website, check this. Eurotunnel warns of lengthy delays due to migrant activity. And this was only published a couple of minutes ago, about 2 minutes ago. Right, look at this. Eurotunnel, the operator said there were delays in Kent of around an hour before check-in and 90 minutes on site. That's 2.5 hours to start with, isn't it? You're just sitting there trying to get through everyone. Police warned of more delays due to Operation Stack. It sounds like a McDonald's, doesn't it? A stack of burgers. Operator Stack, which shuts part of the coastbound M20 to cars. And I saw the pictures on the news this morning. That motorway is chock-a-block. Nothing's moving. But not only that, the roads around the side of the motorway are also chock-a-block because everyone's trying to go round. Oh, my God. And there are caravans and cars and camper vans and not to mention the articulated lorries. All stuck on these roads. Must be horrendous. I hate traffic. Do you know what I reckon? I reckon it's Prius drivers. I'm not so sure about the whole migrants thing. I think there are several Prius drivers driving in a line across all the... And they're doing 24 mile an hour that Prius drivers do all the time. And they're all minicabs. And Prius drivers, I hate them. I absolutely hate them. Can they not drive? Is it a thing that Prius drivers perhaps... They can buy it. Has the government got some sort of thing out that Prius drivers are allowed to buy the car without actually passing a test? God's sake. It's just hopeless. Now, what's that there? Simon says, at least your flowers got through. Well, that's the most important thing, dear. The flowers came through. How did they get here from Germany if there's all those cars stacking up? Because it's been going on a few days now, hasn't it? It goes on. Eurotunnel services have been hit by strikes and migrants targeting lorries for weeks. On Friday, many were held up in one of the busiest days of the year for travel. And shortly before midnight on Friday, Eurotunnel was forced to briefly close after migrants accessed the Eurotunnel terminal on the French side. What are we going to do about them all? There's hundreds of them. Hundreds of them trying to get over here, dear. On one side of the coin, you can say that their life is so bad they're trying to get to somewhere else. And we should help them. On the other side of the coin, you could say, well, this is our country. No one else is coming in. I wonder where you lie on that. Maybe somewhere along the middle, perhaps. We've got to do something. Because obviously the French can't control it. I mean, how hard must it be, right? This is what I don't understand. How hard must it be to have a little hole, and it ain't that big, a little hole just going into a tunnel and to keep that secure? How hard can that be? Surely it can't be that difficult. For as the lorries come through, you know, open the back door, right, no one in here, through you go. You'd need perhaps a few more people. But as this bit here, look, migrants accessed the Eurotunnel terminal. How does that happen? I just don't get it. You know, if I had some burglars coming to my front door, I'd bloody well fight them off. If I was standing there, I wouldn't let them through. How can they be getting into the tunnel? That's what I just don't understand. If I go speeding down the motorway, I will be seen and photographed. Police cars will follow me. Oh, I'm sorry, sir. Do you know how fast you were going? One car out of millions driving around the UK road, and I will be spotted speeding. I will be spotted parking on the double red line for 30 seconds. So how comes they can't see hundreds of people trying to get into a tunnel? It's a joke. It's a joke. Other travel updates. P&O ferries say services from Dover and Calais were running with delays of around 60 minutes because everyone's trying to get on the boats now, aren't they? We never had this problem before the bloody tunnel. Did we? Never had this problem. We didn't have hundreds of people trying to get on boats. No, they couldn't get on. They'd be chucking them in the sea, dear. Chuck them in the sea. Shocking. Absolutely shocking. BBC correspondent Simon Jones said Eurotunnel was trying to deal with around 50,000 passengers on Saturday, one of the busiest days of the year to travel. I don't know. It doesn't say anything about the airlines at all. Long-term solution? I don't know. Adam the plumber is calling in. Adam on line 7. Good morning, Adam.
Hello, Chris.
Good morning.
How are you, dear?
Are you speaking into the phone?
I am.
Oh, maybe I'll turn you up here then. Try again, dear.
Testing, 1, 2, 3.
Oh, that's much better. Was I on speakerphone then?
No, just normal phone.
I bet I was on your speakerphone, weren't I?
No, you're just on normal phone, dear.
Good morning, Adam. How are you? Are you going to France, dear?
God, no. I couldn't stand the place.
All those
foreigners trying to get in the back of my car, no thank you.
Oh, it's horrendous. They try and get in the cars as well, don't they?
Apparently so, yes.
So what happens, right? Well, I wonder what would happen, right? If someone was trying to climb into your lorry and you told them to get off and they didn't get off and you smacked them in the mouth, you'd get in trouble. I bet you'd get in trouble.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Dare you get in my blooming lorry? Get out! Don't care who you are.
Apparently, I've been following this for quite some time and sort of phoning in radio shows talking about this. And the lorry drivers are absolutely petrified of going near the Calais, going near the terminals and what have you, because the guys are breaking in and they're using violence to get in the cabs and they can't do anything about it.
Oh, it's awful, absolutely awful.
If it was down to me, I'd send them back down to their own country and tell them to get on with it.
Well, I don't understand why they can't do that. We keep letting in all these people, but how is it that they can't... Have you seen the Eurotunnel? When I say it's a small hole, it's a bit bigger than that. But at the end of the day, it's a hole.
I work in it.
Oh, you work in it?
Sometimes, yeah, not on the French side, but on the UK side.
What do you do?
I'm a plumber and drainage engineer for the railways. So part of my job is sometimes to go down the Eurotunnel.
Right, okay.
And jobs down there.
What's the
it's a horrible place to be in, and basically, if you went in there and a train went through, you wouldn't survive.
There's no gap then, no.
There are walkways. There's a walkway that goes all the way along.
Right.
If those trains go through it, it would just pull you off and kill you.
Right.
There are refuges every half a mile. Every half a mile, there's refuge doors.
But if there's a train coming, you couldn't run to that door, could you?
No, God, no, no. The train would definitely beat you. And if you were to open that door from the outside, it would shut the tunnel down anyway because they're an emergency tunnel. They're not escape tunnels. What they are, they connect between each platform, each side of the platform.
Right.
So for instance, half a mile down, you'll have a set of doors that you push open with an emergency bar, and then that leads through onto the other tunnel.
Ah.
So say there was a problem in the tunnel, and they had to evacuate the train. They open all these doors, and they send you through onto the other tunnel, and then they bring the train through and get you out.
Right.
And these doors are fire sealed and everything else. They do have pods that come up onto the surface.
They have what?
They have these what they call head houses, which come out to the surface.
Head what?
They've got head houses.
Head houses.
Yeah, and they actually come up to the surface. They actually come up to the surface. They're for maintenance people to get in to come down and do maintenance work on the tunnels.
Right.
But again, to get out of one of those would be near on impossible unless you've got all the codes and everything else.
Right, right.
So, going into those tunnels is extremely dangerous. I mean, but we're not allowed in them until the railway system is actually shut down overnight.
Have you been very close to, like, a train when it's gone past?
I have, yeah. We can work in what we call a safe area.
Yes.
I won't give out the locations where these are, but there's a safe area, and we can actually be working in that safe area. Say we're doing the sump pump drainage for the tunnel. It comes out into the open eventually and then gets pumped out into the sewers in the street. Now, we can actually work in that area, and sometimes when the fast trains go by, you really do sort of breath intake, and you're sort of, I don't know.
How fast are they going?
From memory, and I'm going to get shot if I don't remember this, I think they're around 200 miles an hour.
Gosh.
50 miles an hour.
So when you're down there, because obviously you said you work, you do the plumbing down there, does it take you long to, presumably you're in there with a couple of buckets, and the sea leaks into the tunnel when you have to keep fishing that out and chucking it out, do you?
Well, no, there's all pumping systems for all that.
Is it you doing that on your own, Adam, or is there a few people assisting you?
Yeah, it's just me down there on my own, bailing out the sea. I mean, I only go as far as where does I go? Folkestone.
Yeah.
We do from King's Cross International through to Folkestone.
Right.
And then that's the end of our journey, as it were. But it is actually a really frightening place to be in.
Yeah.
And, if the trains were running, you would never survive.
You know, like the underground trains?
Yeah.
I've heard that where the rail is, there's like a bit underneath.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? So if a train was coming...
Yep.
Then you could get in a bit underneath the rail and the train would go over you. Is that right? Or don't you know?
On a railway train, on an overhead train, you probably could. I don't know if you would survive duck and cover. Let me see.
On the underground trains. You're waving that phone around at your mouth. Keep it in one place, dear.
It is in one place, dear.
No, sometimes you're loud, then you're not. I haven't got my Skype thing gone on again, is it? I can hear what you're doing. You're doing that. You're doing that. It must remain in front of your little pretty mouth.
Oh, thank you, Freddie. Right, so, as I say, with an underground train, they've obviously got what they call the fourth rail system.
Yes.
So you've got that middle rail.
Yes,
now,
yes.
If you're lucky, you can lay in between that, as long as you don't touch it, because, again, that is electrified.
Oh, right.
A lot of people are under the misunderstanding that those rails are only live when trains going over them, they're not. They're like 24/7 until they switched off.
Now that that middle rail is actually over the gap that you could get down, isn't it?
Yeah, that's right.
So you wouldn't be able to get down. Well, you wouldn't be able to get down there anyway, would you?
No, you're talking about in the actual stations.
Yeah, you know, like there's the two rails.
Yep.
And then there's one in the middle, which is that live one. And then there's a dip underneath that live rail, isn't there?
Where that's right, yeah.
It looked like you could lay down in there. So you couldn't get down there, could you, if that rail's live?
You could get down there as long as you didn't touch that rail.
How could you do it without touching the rail? I don't think you could.
Well, people have been lucky to fall down. Well, when people have been unlucky to fall off the platform or what have you.
Right.
They have been lucky enough to fall into that bit. I mean, I don't deal with the underground. I only deal with network rail.
But right.
Network rail, you've got two systems there. You've got the third rail system, which is the one down on the ground. And that's always furthest away from the platform. If you go to a railway station and you see the third rail, it's always raised up about 2 inches above from the other two rails.
Yes, yes.
And that's got 750 volts DC in it.
Oh, I say. Oh, so I'd be fried to smithereens. I look like a fried egg.
Oh, yeah. And you think that's bad. You know the wires are above your head?
Yes.
The ones that are overhead, they're 25,000 volts.
I need those volts in me now. Put them in me. Put them in me now. I'll put my hands up, darling. I want to hold on to those and feel that power going through my body. If I was a pigeon, I could just land on it. No trouble at all, couldn't I?
Exactly, yes. You need to come back as a pigeon. That's what it is.
So we're not going to France, are we?
I'm not going to France. No, definitely not going to France, dear.
But Simon is on the Isle of Wight. Do you think the Isle of Wight might be a better option in this instance?
I love the Isle of Wight. My surrogate sister lives out there, the Isle of Wight diva, and she lives out there, and I go out there all the time. Lovely place to visit, the Isle of Wight.
Yeah, it's been years since I've been. I like the way the train gets right there, and then you just walk on the boat, don't you? Oh, it's fantastic,
yeah,
that is.
Yeah, the old 1936 London Underground trains.
Are they still using those ones?
Yeah, I think they're upgrading it, because I recently did some work on that.
Simon will know that.
Yeah, I recently worked on that as well.
Good God. I remember getting on those. Whoa, it must have been about... It's about... I haven't been on the Isle of Wight for about... I tell you what, it was 1983.
Mm-hmm.
93. All right. My God, yeah. I haven't been on there for 30 years. 83, 93, 03, 13. I haven't been on the Isle of Wight for 32 years.
Well, there you go. There's
That's unbelievable, isn't it?
Perfect opportunity to take your Periscope and your YouTube and do a broadcast from there.
I might like to do that. Are you going on any holidays this year, Adam?
Yes, I've got one booked to Spain this year. It's the first one in 8 years.
España? What part? Benidorm?
Not sure. It's being organised by my partner Sean. He's sort of organising all, because I know nothing about holidays. I say, just book it, give me the receipt, and I'll pay you for it.
Yeah. Oh well, that's fair. That's the sort of thing I'd do, I think.
You know, just book me in business class and leave me alone.
Oh, is there anywhere you'd like to go that you haven't been yet?
New York. It's my ultimate dream to go to New York.
Never been to New York. Okay.
Never been to America. No, I'd love to go there.
You don't know what you're missing there.
And Australia.
Well, don't worry about being hungry. Massive portions of food and dirt cheap clothes. Really,
oh,
is
right,
there.
Okay.
Not in the big stores like Macy's. No, you need to go to an out-of-town, a designer outlet.
Mm-hmm.
So when you go, or sort it out before you go, just start designer outlets New York and you'll find really cheap clothes there.
Sounds good, Chris. Sounds good.
All right. Thank you, Adam. Nice to talk to
all
you.
All right. And you, Chris. Bye for now.
Cheerio. Adam the Plumber calling the singing plumber, boys and girls, who's on Periscope. We're on Periscope 1 this morning. But if you're with us on Periscope, I can't see your messages. We don't have the messages running while I'm doing this particular show, OK? But you can join in by phone, 0208 144 3477, or you can Skype in at United Kingdom Talk. The Skype in is United Kingdom Talk. Good morning to Millie in Minnesota, who's with us this morning as well. Richard said, did you see that lot on the back of those unchecked train carriages? No, I didn't see that. How can they be unchecked with everything going on? Also, how many of these jihadis who want to do us harm? No one knows. Makes me mad, Chris. Yeah, I mean, it's horrendous how people can just get on the back of a train and no one notices. Where are the cameras? It makes me so mad. They've got the cameras for the bad motorists that make a mistake now and again. But there's no cameras on the back of a train that can see migrants. I mean, what planet are these people on who run the country sometimes? Richard also says, our son Roman is in stitches watching you be electrocuted. Would you like me to actually do it? Shall I plug my... Shall I plug myself in somewhere and watch me do it? I do have a couple of trains with me this morning, boys and girls. There's still, you might have seen these on my Periscope. So YouTube people won't have seen those. I have my Flying Scotsman. Look at that. Hey, look at that. The Flying Scotsman train. Roman, you need daddy to buy you one of these. And I have my Princess Victoria electric train. Oh, we like our toys. We do. Where have you been on holiday? Or where do you want to go? Would you go to France? Who's been to France recently? I mean, the last time I went to France, that was even longer ago. Oh, no, it didn't. No, I did a couple of jobs, didn't I, at a ski resort a couple of times. Yeah, they were quite good. Yeah, I really enjoyed doing those. La Alpes de Hughes, I think it was called. I may have the accent wrong. Le Alpes de Youth. Le Alpes de Hughes, which was a beautiful place. I was doing some DJing and comparing at a place. The name of the resorts now. Club Med. I did this for a number of years. And it was very nice. And it was in a skiing resort. I did try the skiing just once. Just once, and I'm afraid not very successful. Eventually, I did manage to get from one end to the other of the very amateur section, which was almost flat, to be honest, but it just wasn't for me. And I hated those boots that you have to wear. Has anyone been skiing? Anyone been skiing? I want to call in about it. 020-8144-3477. 0208-144-3477 or Skype in on United Kingdom Talk if you've been skiing. I would like to know about it. What is it about skiing that you love? Is it the fact that you're going down at 200 mile an hour and you might go off the side? Doesn't that worry you? Well, it didn't worry these two people. Look at this. Similar thing. Okay. Josh Robinson in today's Daily Mail and friend Danny25 were named on social media. The pair were racing near Bruck on holiday. It was on an alpine pass. Okay? When the vehicle skidded and tumbled down the slope. I mean, the driver of a 280 BHP hot hatch, which careered off the top of a mountain pass, told a friend days before he died, I won't be careful. He's 22, honestly. 22, and his mate Danny was 25. Joked with Paula, which is his friend, that he wouldn't be careful. Driving his 2010 Seat Leon Cupra across Europe. The pair were one day away from returning home after driving across some of Europe's most challenging and spectacular roads. And now he's dead. How stupid can you be? If you've ever been up a mountain, you will know how narrow these roads are. And at many times of the year, how slippery they are. I was going to a place in Flaine about 15 years ago. Flaine is in France on one of those Club Med tours. And we were on a coach. There was quite a few of us on this like big coach. And we're inching up this mountain. There was a little bit of traffic in front of us. We were taking it easy. And I got to tell you, the roads were quite narrow. Okay, going round the mountain. Well, not necessarily round, but sort of up like that. They go in like zigzag lines to try and get them up, right? And every now and again, he would have to brake because of the traffic in front of us. And I'm not joking, the coach would slide back. It would slide back on the ice. And not all of the road has a barrier going around it. Besides, you know, with, I don't know, 50, 60 people on a coach, 70 people on a coach, I don't know how many it holds. The weight of that coach coming into contact with the barrier, I don't think it would last. And we'd go a little bit further forward, and then he would stop again, and it would slide back on this ice wheel. I was terrified. Absolutely terrified. But at least we were careful. These two idiots, who are now dead, were racing round one of these roads. How stupid can you be? Yes, of course I'm sorry they're dead. But so unnecessary, isn't it? Even you see them on the motorways here, racing each other down the blooming middle of the motorway. Awful. And there are some pictures of this totally wrecked car. You can see those on the front page of the Daily Mail. Okay? Have a look at that. Gosh. Just awful. Just awful. You wanted me to do the electrocution thing again, did you? Are you ready? Or shall I do it in a minute? Go and get your son and I'll do my electrocution thing again. I will, I promise. Where are you going this year? My mate at the moment is in Nice, in southern France. Fortunately, I think he flew there. And he's having a nice time at the moment. Yesterday, they went to Monaco. Is that a country all on its own, Monaco? Or is that a part of France? I'm not quite sure. Someone tell me, please. Where is Monaco? And did they do well at the Eurovision Song Contest? I don't think they did they? So I haven't been to Monaco or anything like that. But it'd be probably in, you know, sitting in cafes, watching the world go by, and he'll have the big glasses on and the hairdo and all that business. He does it all properly, does my mate Ron. So he's on holiday at the moment in France. Are you going anywhere this year? All right, OK. Ronan's ready. Are you ready, Ronan? Here we go. Electrocution. You ready? Switch on the power again. There we are. That's especially for Richard's son, me being electrocuted this morning. We hope you enjoyed that. I haven't got a holiday booked at all this year. At the beginning of the year, I decided while the... All right. At the beginning of the year, I decided to try and pay off some mortgage money because the rates of interest are really low at the moment. And so that's what I've done. I might do the same next year. If I do the same next year as well, I'll be laughing. I'll be laughing. OK, so that's why I'm not going anywhere this year. Where are you going on holiday? Anywhere exciting? Have you been there before? I've been to some lovely places. My favourite, it's difficult to say, really. I went to this place called Norfolk Island in the South Pacific. I'm glad I'm making you laugh this morning. That's beautiful there. And then you've got the Disney. I've been to Caribbean. I've been to Barbados. Now, Barbados, I found it dirty. It's very beautiful. But like the fields where, I don't know, cows and things go, seem to be full of rubbish. Plastic bags and tin cans, and no one goes around and picks them up. The tourist areas, spotless, of course. Bridgetown, it's all right. Bridgetown, there's not a lot in Bridgetown other than jewellery shops. People selling jewellery, that doesn't interest me at all. I was there, I think, 1999 in Barbados. Beautiful place, but rubbish everywhere. Don't understand that. Why don't anyone pick it up? And it was everywhere. Rubbish. St. Lucia, Caribbean again. Beautiful. Really enjoyed it there. Lovely, lovely place. Went on little tours and things like that there. There was with... Who was I with there? Oh, I was best man at my friend's wedding in St. Lucia. We were staying at a place called Club St. Lucia, I think it was, on the south there. That was very pleasant. And I found this cove, big cove, where you could sit out of the sun. It wasn't to, because it was very, very hot there. But you went in this cove and it was kind of shaded and quite pleasant down there. So that was that. Where are you going on holiday this year? Let me know. 0208 144 3477. 0208 144 3477. Or you can Skype in. The Skype in is United Kingdom Talk. Okay, Skype in is United Kingdom Talk. Is it Jeff? Jeff was asking this morning, where did I get my new disco light from? And it was from eBay, actually. They vary in price from like about 120 quid to about 15. You know which one I bought, don't you? Of course, the £15 version. Thank you very much. And I had them on last night. You might have seen in the Periscope video last night, available still on the replay, I think. Or you can see it on my Facebook wall as well. I did sing last night, Money, Money, Money from ABBA. Money, money, money must be funny in a rich man's world. I didn't actually do that bit. That was just done now for effect. But I got two new dome lights and they're just plastic things. Very light. Plug them in and let them go. One each side of the stage. Little pretty lights everywhere. 15 quid you can get them for. Be careful though, Jeff, because there are large ones and there are small ones. You don't want a small... I think a small one's about the size of your hand. You want something a little bit bigger than that. Do you know, I'm starving today. I don't know why. I'm really hungry. I want to put my dinner on, actually. Do you mind if I go down and put the oven on? Or is that, like, really unprofessional? Can I... I want to put my dinner on. I do. I'm very... This might be a shorter show today because I'm hungry. Would you mind if it was shorter? Do you mind? I'm feeling very, very hungry this morning. What else have we got here? Oh, yes. Richard, who's with us today with his little boy, has been splashing people. He said, have you ever done this to anyone, Chris? I did it in about 2006. Not deliberately. Oh, yeah, we've all heard that one before. Not deliberately. I pulled over to avoid a car who was over and over my side of the road and completely drenched this guy. You're doing it on purpose, aren't you? I know you're doing it on purpose, Rich. Don't lie to me. Huh? You naughty man. I would never do such a thing on purpose. Terrible thing to say. Absolutely awful thing to say. Now, what else have we got here? Aha! Good news, those of you who want to continue to look at trying to look young. Have you tried that yet? Richard, you don't need to do this yet. Another year, maybe. Millie, how would you like to look young again? Lovely Millie. Again in the mail this morning. Scientists have discovered how to switch off the ageing process in worms. Worms. Now, I don't know about you, but I've looked at many worms in my life, and I find it very difficult to tell the age. Which ones are old? And which ones are young? I don't know. The study of worms showed adult cells abruptly beginning their downhill slide when they reach reproductive maturity. A genetic switch then allows aging to begin by turning off certain processes which protect cells within the body. Have you had any of your certain processes turned off? That's the question to you today, I ask. The finding is significant because humans have the same generic switch and means eventually it may be possible to delay aging and certain degenerative diseases. I mean, I am practically degenerating before your very eyes, dear. Aren't I? Look at me. I've aged at least 50 years since starting this show this morning. It may seem like 50 years I've been talking to some of you. Would I be right? The results published in the Journal of Molecular... Oh, hang on, it's jumped forward there. My page has just jumped down. Published in the Journal of Molecular Cell, claimed to pinpoint the start of ageing. Disproving the theory that ageing is a slow series of random events. And there was me thinking it was all planned out. It starts much earlier. Knowing more about the quality control system works in cells could help researchers one day figure it all out. So have we got to eat loads of worms to look young? Is that what they're saying here? Because I can't work it out. Would you do that? Would you take a handful of worms and start shoving them in your mouth if you thought it was going to make you look young, knowing that they won't actually damage you? But there they be, inside your tummy, wriggling away, dear. Wriggling away. Oh, how awful. I think I'd rather look old. Worms. I mean, how do they know if a worm looks old or not? They all look the same to me. Big fat ones, little pink ones, going around in the earth, burying their little tunnels. We're back onto the Eurotunnel. Do you think migrants try to get in the little holes created by worms? Do they try and do that? Is anyone try? Are the tunnels created by worms being securely protected? We don't want jihadists coming through there. I'm actually considering, because I've had no luck recently finding someone to love me, I'm actually now considering becoming a jihadi bride. I'm looking for cheap flights to Syria. I'm going to have one of those black veil things, and I may well become a jihadi bride. I am considering that now. I don't know what you think of that. There's just no other way, is there? Never mind. Using a combination of generic and biochemical approaches. It's all long words here today. Professor Morimoto. That is his name. It is. Morimoto. Found the protective heat shock response declined steeply over a 4-hour period. What are they going on about, dear? Why do we need young worms? Why don't they do it to humans and make us look young? We don't need young worms. Maybe they can plug themselves in and have electric shocks and make them look younger. Ah, 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 ah. Terrible. Would you eat worms? 0208-144-3477 is the call-in number. I might give up on the call-in number today. Or Skype in. All one word. United Kingdom Talk. Skype in, all one word, United Kingdom Talk, all right? Yeah, I do need professional help. You know I need professional help. Another story here. We're going to finish up on this one today. We're going to have an early finish today because I'm hungry. Very, very hungry. And I don't feel I'm flowing very well today. Am I not flowing? All these subjects and not a single corner message. What on earth am I doing wrong today? Are you just shocked by the blue jacket and the pink shirt underneath? Is that what it is? Am I not flowing? I must be doing something wrong today. Maybe we've gone off air. Could that be it? Have we gone off air? Are we still alive? Are you still alive? And now a word from our sponsor. The Right Honourable Terry Wogan. Da 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 da. Terry Wogan. Ba ba ba. Radio 2. And Terry says, fresh and fragrant. Before he'll even consider sitting down to chat, Sir Terry Wogan, fresh and fragrant in white slacks, crisp shirt and naked ankles, whisks me away on an extensive tour of Wogan Towers in the Daily Mail this morning. We take in his vast drawing room, a lily-festooned magnificent of cut glass, shiny piano, silver photo frames and candle holders made of giant seashells. Oh, is that all? I think my living room's quite plain. I've got lots of photos and mementos of people on there and places that I've visited. No sticks of rock, though. I've eaten all those. Do you know when I went to Brucklesham Bay the other week? We did a YouTube programme down there. There were no sticks of rock. Why is that? Have people stopped eating rock? Is that the reason? He says, I hold the record for the for being on the most cover of the Radio Times. He's been on Radio Times front cover more than anyone else, Mr. Sir Terry Wogan. Perhaps he could be my agent. Would that work? Shall I have a word with Terry? Do you think he'd want to be my agent? Terry Wogan. Ba 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 ba. Terry Wogan. I love the old jingles. Then it's outside to admire the endless sloping lawns, spectacular wisteria. We do like a bit of purple wisteria hanging down. Swimming pool. He's got a swimming pool, dear. Oh, no. Don't ask me about swimming pools. So yesterday, I went up. Oh, Richard's having corned beef fritters today for dinner. Mmm. I like pineapple fritters. Have you had pineapple fritters before? They're quite nice. So the swimming pool yesterday, so I went on my usual 25-minute walk to the swimming pool, making a few calls at the same time. Got up there, swimming pool closed. Now, they've done this before. Now, do you go swimming? Because I'm going to tell you something now. You may not want to listen to this bit. Ready? Apparently, and this is the second time this has happened, a child was sick in the swimming pool yesterday. Blech. The thing is, what do you think then happens? When a child is sick in the swimming pool, first of all, they close it. No one can get in. Now, what do? Do they empty the pool? Afraid not. They fish out the solid bits with a fishing net. And do you know what they do then? They then increase the level of chlorine in there times 3, I think she said it was. And then they have to wait for it to come back down to a safe level for us humans. And I use the term loosely on myself, being a human, for us to swim again. And when that level comes back down, we go back in there. The idea of increasing the chlorine level in there is to kill everything that's in there. Unfortunately, no one can use it while it's live. So they don't actually change the water. And it's kind of put me off a little bit swimming now. I suppose it takes a long time to empty that pool, doesn't it, of the water. So that's what they do. They don't empty the water. They fish out what they can see as solid bits. They increase the level of the chlorine times 3. Then when it's gone back down to a safe level, I suppose the water is permanently going through filters as well, isn't it? Then they open it again and you go swimming again. Now, how would you feel about going swimming now? Because that's put me right off. I'm sorry it has. I mean, it must happen all the time, mustn't it, when you think about it? Awful, just awful. Awful. Right, we're going to just open our little messaging thing on the those of you watching Periscope now for a little while, for the last 10 minutes or so, just in case you want to ask or say anything. Hello, Charlotte. Good afternoon, Charlotte. And Charlotte says that's put her off swimming. Me too, Charlotte. I mean, I like to get in there with my little budgie smugglers on, dear. Fat. Oozing round the side of the waistband of my swimming trunks. I mean, that's even worse. To see that would be even worse than having a mouthful of water or some kids who've been sick in it, dear. Dreadful, dreadful. Are you going swimming now? So I couldn't go swimming yesterday, but don't worry. Don't worry. Oh, dear. Richard said I've taken a slash in the pool before when I was a kid. I bet you still do it now, don't you, Richard? Can't be bothered to get out of the pool. So you just go in now. Aren't you disgusting, dear? Disgusting. Although it's not as bad as smelly people, I suppose, because we don't like smelly people with bad breath. But it isn't a child's pool, Charlotte. There's only one pool in there at the Hilton Hotel. I still got my money's worth yesterday, though. Even though the pool was closed, I went in and I had a shower and a shave and used their water so that my water meter wouldn't go round. I'm quite pleased about that. All right. Ooh, not nice. Then I walked back and I popped into Audi on the way back and got some of their delicious, what's the name of them? They're cheese and onion handmade crisps. I can't remember the make of them now, but lovely. 89 pence for a massive bag. Yeah, I did. I ate the whole bag. Putting on a bit of weight again at the moment. And I'm not surprised, actually, with some of the stuff I'm eating. I'm very, very bad with the eating at the moment. I don't know why. You know, I go through these periods, I go to lose weight, and then it starts coming back on again. It's the bread, I think. Bread and crisps. And last night on the way home, I had another bar of Cadbury's Dairy Milk Chocolate, which was rather naughty. Naughty of me. Right, well, I think I'm done, really, today. Oh, you put on half a stone from Pringles. Which Pringles do you like? I quite like the barbecue ones. I like the taste of the barbecue Pringles. They're quite nice. Do you like those ones? Oh, barbecue crumbles. Not keen on them. What is it called? Cheese and chives, I think some of them are called. Cheese and chives. What's all that about? Barbecue. They are. She likes the barbecue ones as well. They really are nice. And it is true, once you pop that top lid, you can't put them down, can you? A bit like that. Walker's cheese and onion crisps. Yes, please, any day of the week. Thank you very much. Right, I'm going to leave it there today, boys and girls. Thank you very much for watching and listening to our little show today. Now, I do little shows on Periscope. You get like maybe two or three of those a day sometimes. And it's more interactive. You can talk to me and I'll talk back to you. Okay, so I do Periscopes a couple of times a day. Flavoured Princes. What are Flavoured Princes, Johnny? Flavoured Princes. I don't know what they are. You'll have to tell me what they are, Johnny. Flavoured Princes. So I'm on Periscope as well. It's a free app available for iPhone and Android phones. It's called Periscope. And if you want to add me on there, United Kingdom Talk. United Kingdom Talk. Or they're full of MSN. Yeah, a lot of those crisps and things have got so much salt and that. You know, you pick up this bag of crisps and you say 100 grams or whatever it is. I don't know. And it's like, I don't know, 35% of your daily salt intake. I must say, I don't add salt to anything at all. Anything at all. Not potatoes, vegetables. I add salt. No sugar added to anything either. I don't add sugar to my porridge in the morning or my tea. So I don't actually add salt or sugar to anything whatsoever. But of course, all this food has already got salt and sugar in it, a lot of it. And sugar would appear in the most strangest of places where you wouldn't expect it to be. In fact, sugar, I think you find, is in most foods, even savoury ones. They've put a bit of sugar in it to give it a little bit of flavour or something, haven't they? Thank you very much for joining me today, boys and girls. My email address is chris@unitedkingdomtalk.co.uk if you want to send us an email in at some point. Okay, chris@unitedkingdomtalk.co.uk. See you soon. Bye-bye now.